What is the simplest way to use Wealth Branch? Step 1. I pick a strategy. On the Wealth Branch homepage, I click my favorite strategy, buy the dip. Step 2. I review trading setups. I am presented with a table full of stocks that are in a buy the dip zone on the chart. By default, all stocks are sorted by a Trade Protect score, which helps me avoid buying bankrupt companies. Step 3. I pick a stock. I hover my mouse over the table view of tickers to see what the charts look like, and I pick one that looks like a good setup. I click on the ticker, and this takes me to the leaf page where I can see a larger chart and some statistics to help me determine my stop loss settings for the trade. Step 4. I open a trade and I set my stop loss. On certain days, it really is this easy. I end up here and I am done with my day. But wait, there's more. Bonus number 1. I can find similar setups. I'm excited to introduce this amazing feature. If you've ever wanted to discover successful trade setups resembling a past winning trade, this tool is exactly what you need. I'm presented with a price chart next to today's leaf indicator. The leaf indicator is a visual representation of the strategy. Our system then does some fancy calculations in the background and presents me with other stocks in the market right now that have very similar looking charts. The hard work has already been done in the background and similar setups are revealed below. Bonus number 2. I can browse the historical leaf indicator. When I click on the chart on any day in the past, the leaf indicator is visually updated to that day. I then click plant seed and then I am presented with stocks today that match the pattern from the past. This is extremely powerful and is not available anywhere else. I can then save my favorite leaf patterns that I come across and find similar patterns every day that match my trading style.
To get started, sign up today. Now that you have a glimpse of what Wealth Branch can do, you can either jump right in and explore results yourself, or you can watch the rest of this video as I'm going to walk you through a complete tutorial of every page on wealthbranch.com. I will start with a basic guide to get you started and then dive into more advanced features. I'm going to go through every page and click on every button and explain everything as if I were using it today myself. This will be a complete tutorial, so feel free to skip around and come back to this video as a reference to become more familiar with these tools. So let's jump right in. I'm not going to go over a script right here. I don't even have an outline. I'm just going to go page by page and click on all the buttons. So let's go with the home page. On the home page, we have a search box and you can type in a ticker or you can type in company name, Apple. Or what was the one below that? So then we got a whole bunch of hospitality companies. So you can hover over these and then just click on one and it'll take you to the leaf page that shows all the stats. Also what happens in the search box, if you want to clear the page, you can click the little X and this just does the same thing as hitting enter. So if you type in Apple and hit enter key, it'll just go straight to it. Or you can click the search icon and it does the same thing. This is a dice roll. It'll just load a random stock. And you can keep clicking it for other stocks. The stats that show up in the pop-ups here. So if I let's do like a letter A or something so I can see a bunch of them. We are showing the zone number. And then this is the long-term, medium-term, and short-term trends. Which is the same thing that you see on the leaf here. So zone, short, medium, long. And then it's also the same arrows that are here. So for example, if I click on the chart here in the past, you can see this is all these EMAs are in a downtrend. So that's what you're looking at here. So if I click over here, they're all up in the uptrend. If I try to get one in the middle here where some of them are down or up, there's one of the medium trend is going down. If you go onto another page, this little leaf icon will take you back to whatever the last leaf was that you looked at. So if I go to the macro page, and then I just click on the leaf again, it's going to take me back to the Apple page. So if you get lost and lose your leaf, or lose the ticker that you were on, you can just click the leaf, and it will go back to it. So let's go to the home page again. On the home page, this is going to be more elaborate over time, as we are in kind of an early access beta. But we're going to have stock trading strategies, and these will eventually go to blog posts that will have much more thorough detailed strategies to go over. But for now, they're basically screeners. So this whole page is full of stock screeners that you can go through and click on to find various trading setups. So in the beginning of the video, I did the buy the dip. You could do fade the rip here. So this is going to be a lot of tickers that look like they're, you know, they've gone up a bit in recent days and weeks. And so I'm not saying you want to short on any of these, but you could. So let's go back to the homepage here. Let's just do, I'll do the buy the dip. Everybody knows what buy the dip is. All right, so this is the table view. If you click on advanced here, this is basically the screener page. This will also be the same as clicking on screener up here. So this is going to take you to a generic screener where everything's just sorted by market cap. So these are all the top tickers by market cap. But once you come from the home page, it's actually a short link to filling out the settings that are in these buttons here. So the first thing you can do is change the grid view. So if you always want to see the chart grid, which is the bigger one that has the charts, you can do that, and it'll remember your setting every time you come back to the screener. Or if you like to start with the table view, which is a little bit more condensed, and then you just hover over to get the chart, you can do that. By default, it is on the table view, but then once you click on a ticker, it takes you to the leaf view. So if we go back to the screener, I'm just going to go through the different settings here in the screener. So we have different branches. Right now we have stocks and ETFs. The focus that we're on right now is mostly stocks, and we're going to add crypto here very soon. So there'll be a stock, ETFs, and crypto section in here. And then when you search for the ticker, you'll have cryptos coming up as well. Now, if you click on basket, basket is it's like a watch list. It's a group of stocks. It's just a basket of stocks. So I could do top 10 NASDAQ, top 2000 NASDAQ, the Russell 2000, which if you're not familiar with what the Russell 2000 is, it's actually the stocks ranked by market cap, roughly speaking, of between 1000 and 3000. And then anything above the top 1000, you could actually get from right here if you wanted. And then we have world stocks. That'd be anything that's non-USA. And then we have USA only as well. You can do by exchange, either NASDAQ or NYSE typically. We have sectors, and then we have market cap. So if I want to do some micro caps here, you can just change it and it shows up immediately. So that is it for baskets, other than if you want to create your own basket. So when you're hovering over tickers, there's a little basket icon, and you can create your own list of baskets right here and then add it. So it's kind of like a watch list. And if you click on manage baskets on that pop-up, it'll take you to your page where you have a bunch of baskets, and you can see the tickers here that are included in that basket. And if you just click the red X, you can remove it. So if I want to remove, what is this, Goodyear? It's gone. So now it's not on that list. So I'll come back to this later. So let's go back to screeners. So that's if you have your default basket and you want to just look at the basket stocks, you can do that, or filter by baskets. If you click on leaf, so when you look at the leaf icon, and let me change this to leaf view so we get some bigger leaf icons. So you can see here there are zone, crossover, bots, short-term, mid-term, and long-term. That's what's in the leaf here. So what these are is the zone is basically the top to bottom of kind of the cycle.
So when you look at the price chart over here, we have a bunch of EMAs. And if the price is above all of these EMAs, you're basically in a zone 5. And there's a range, it's basically 2 decimals. So it's all the way from plus 5 extreme to minus 5 extreme bearish. So if I click down here, it's going to be like minus 4-ish, 4.5 there, minus 4.5. So it's pretty bearish. And then, so in the screener up above, you can filter by any of these numbers. So you could come up with your own strategy and then save that leaf as you want, and then come back to it, click on it every day, and look at whatever results are available today for that screener that you built. We do have some other technical stuff that you can search by here. These are all also zoned. So if you want, it's basically kind of like a normalized version of all 6 of these items. So if you have an extreme Bollinger Band, you can do plus 5 or plus 4 and do a filter for that. And then we have additional filters under here. There's a whole bunch of crossovers available. We have some EMA trends being bearish or bullish. And then you can actually mix and match up to 3 of these EMA trends. So if you're looking for particular crossovers or anything like that, you can do that as well. We have a huge price range that you can filter by. And then you can filter by market caps, volume, and then how old the company is. And then sort, we have a whole array of different ways to sort. So let's see, market cap, most active, most expensive. Strong financials is going to be, and the technicals are going to be basically the trade protect score. So like if I change this, the trade protect score right here is 100. So this one, this whatever this company is here, I don't have no idea what it is, has lots of cash. So they're probably not going to go bankrupt anytime soon. And there you go. See, Nvidia's number 2. So they're very high up. And this is based on some of the other filters I think I have set. So if you want to clear all the filters, you can just hit reset right here. And that'll just do the basic, which means highest market caps first, which you can see under here, sorted by highest market cap. If you want to do most active, I'm assuming it's like Tesla or Nvidia or something. Yeah, Tesla's number 2, Apple's 3. So if you save any of these, just click the save button to save whatever you have set, and just give it a name and a description, and then you can click on my screeners. And on my screeners here, it shows you what settings you have. You can copy and share this link, and it'll be a little short link to whatever the screener is if you want to share it with anybody. This share link over here is also right there, you can edit it, change the description, title, save it, delete it if you want. And then this little eye icon here, you can load it. So I'll load it in here, and then whatever settings I had set will be right here. This is your custom description, your custom title, and you'll have the settings that are set. So this was a double death, which I think is a silver cross and a golden cross, but both down. So stocks that are just getting murdered. All right, so that's the screener. Let's go to calendar. So this is the economic calendar. Typically you would click on high, and it'll remember your setting. If you come back here, you can set it to like this week and high, and it'll show what's coming up this week. So we actually had the Federal Reserve rate decision was today at the time of this recording, and they did not change rates. So you can see the stat in there. And then ISM PMI is tomorrow. So if you want to see items that aren't as important, you can go down to medium and even low. So you can see a whole bunch of stuff that's in here. And these are updated about every 5 or 10 minutes during the day. So if the stats come in, then they get updated in here. So that is the economic calendar. And then we also have an earnings calendar. And our earnings calendar has a couple different filters. So you can do the evening stocks or just the morning stocks. And you can do, so I do all this week. So Monday was McDonald's. So pretty basic. There's nothing really advanced going on here. It'll remember your settings. So that's that. Now let's go to the macro page, which this page is interesting. It's pretty basic setup right now. We're probably going to add some more kind of macroeconomic charts to this page with its history. But right now, we're just tracking basic ISM and Chicago PMI to kind of figure out where the business cycle is. So liquidity comes into the market in kind of seasons, right? We've got summer season, fall season. You know, when we're in winter, typically recessionary area, or, you know, we're just getting just killed. The markets are just getting killed. And then when you're up here in the top, these are, you know, prices of everything are just going up because everybody's making money, everybody's printing money, everybody's throwing money around, investing. You know, that's the blow off top area here. As you can see, this was 2021 when markets went nuts. And then when they started raising interest rates, the business cycle just crashed down and activity just, it was death. So at the time of this video, you know, we're looking at like July 2024, kind of in the end of that winter cycle and hopefully looking to turn back up for another year or two. So we're tracking 80 international central banks and whether or not they have raised or lowered rates on their last meeting. So this is not just USA. This is the whole world. So right now, the world has been lowering rates in a lot of different countries to fight deflation. Whereas if you scroll down to the USA has not. You can see this yellow line here. We're just going sideways and not lowering rates. Now this stuff's important because you can see here in 2021 when the markets were raging, the Treasury market actually started going up months before the Fed did anything. And that's when the market started to turn. That was it. So then once the Fed come in and started raising rates, anything in high risk like stocks and asset prices just got absolutely murdered. So this is definitely important to keep in keep on your radar. And so we have the Treasury rates overlaid over top of what the Fed's doing because they'll kind of lead in a way. So as you can see, the Fed didn't raise rates today, and then we got another one in, so they didn't raise or lower rates. They just kept them at where they were. But in 6 weeks, they're expected to lower. And you can see the market's kind of already veering down a bit. So the Fed, as always, is behind. So we'll see what happens in September if they're going to catch up to where all these Treasury rates are. And then we put the inversion on here, which typically when this crosses over, it usually ends up in recession, as you can see back here in 2007, 2008 when it turned. But who knows? Every market's different. So we'll see what happens. But what the Fed is going to do is basically dependent on what this chart is here. So the Fed has two mandates. They have a mandate of making sure inflation doesn't get out of control, which they absolutely failed at in 2021, and then raised rates to kill this yellow line. This yellow line was way too high for a long time, and they finally got it back down by destroying the economy with their interest rate raising. So that's their first mandate, is to get this yellow line down to this kind of center area. That's their goal, to get it to this the straight yellow line here. And then their second mandate is max unemployment, which is what they say, which sounds more pleasant. But really what they're saying is they need to have a certain amount of people unemployed. Otherwise, if too many people are employed, then that causes more buying pressure and causes prices of things to go up, causes more inflation. Like if nobody was unemployed, there'd be tons of inflation, apparently. They figured out the math a long time ago. And they have this base rate, which ends up getting lower over time. So as you can see, the target is 4.42%.
or 4.41%. But like back here, it was 4.8 or something. So over time, it's getting lower. At least that's how they're calculating it. So they want that orange line, which is the actual unemployment rate, to be right at the straight target. So that's something to keep an eye on. We have some other random stuff in here that we might change or might add or remove some of these items. But you can see there was a lot of cash sitting on the sidelines, and it's been piling back into stocks. Stocks have been kind of raging for the last 6 to 12 months because that cash stopped. People stopped putting money in money markets and started taking it out and putting it in assets. Then we have the two real estate charts on here that are pretty interesting. So if you look back at like 2007 when the real estate market crashed, it just went absolutely. The supply kept going up, and then just absolutely tanked after that. Then you have the demand. So you can see since everybody stopped getting free money from the government, the demand for housing has kind of fell off a cliff. And then we have consumer sentiment down here, which is just a general sense of where normal people are thinking the markets are. So that's the macro page. This is also similar on the daily post, and then we might change this up a bit, but it's kind of explains what I just explained. So you could go through here and read this stuff, and then we might change some of these charts, add some more, remove them, but it's basically a summary of the other page. And then we have this breath page. So we just have a basic, this is middle of the day. So if you have this open in the middle of the day, this updates every couple minutes, I think, and shows the market breath, some stats. And then we have this cool thing that we built that we're calling the heat map. And it's probably not clear, but if you go down to the bottom here, we've got all the sectors on the top, and then we have a few sections like world, international, USA, the Dow, S&P 500, NASDAQ, and then we have the caps. So you can go mega cap all the way down to micro cap. And if you click on these, it changes the chart. And this is a summary of all the stocks that are in this zone. So if I look at, let's look at like technology stocks. So this is all technology stocks, and you can see how many stocks it is. We're analyzing 5,600 stocks. So all the technology stocks that are in that giant allotment are included in here and then mapped based on where their zone is. So if all the technology stocks are getting killed, which they were here in 2022, you can see most of the stocks were red. A lot of them were in -5, just absolutely getting blasted. And so this tends to be, you know, if you're looking at market breadth alone, tends to be good times to buy stocks. I think October 2022 was the actual kind of bottom. And then you can see more and more green has kind of happened over time. But once you get these dips down here, it's generally a overall market kind of purchase area or accumulation area. And then when stuff's up here in the red, it's generally toppy. Just means most of the money is in the market. When you're up here in these top little spikes, most of the money's in the market already, as opposed to has left the market and gone into cash or non-risk assets. I know utilities was getting killed for a while there. Yeah, see, this is way down here. Utilities, all these utility stocks were getting absolutely blasted, but now they've made a comeback, pretty big comeback. I think in recent weeks, months, if you look at IWM, so I think that's the Russell. So Russell 2000's made kind of a comeback, whereas it was getting killed for a long time. So you could click on this, and then I could actually click on the little link here for this section and look at the actual stocks. And I think they're sorted by, I want to say, market cap. Yeah, that's 2 billion. So I think that's right underneath the limit. So I think they're sorted by market cap. So if that's 2 billion, this is 2 billion. So these are the top stocks with that market cap setting, which you can see under, yes, small cap filter. Or probably sort highest market cap in, I think it's a basket. Yeah, it's a market cap basket, small cap basket. So that's where the filter is. So if I go back to the breath page, let me just look at this and see what else. You can change the time of the chart. So you could really zoom in if you want and go to like 90 days or... So let's go back to, I'll just go to where I was, stocks, small cap stocks. And we'll go over this whole section here. Starting from the left here, logo ticker. You can actually click on these three links. So if you want to go to the NASDAQ or the sector or the industry and filter stocks by that, you can do so. These four icons or your personal icons other than this one's actually the company info. So if you're scrolling through here and you're like, I don't know what the heck Clear Secure is, what does this do? Just click the I, and then you can see a full description of the company, how many employees they have, and then go to their website and then see when it was listed. And then a couple stats here, a little bit of fundamental stats, and whether or not it has a dividend or not. So these three icons out of the four are for your personal stuff. So if you like this leaf here, you can save it, give it a name, give it a description, and then you can manage the leaves and go to the leaf page. Same if you want to save it as a basket or save it to a basket of tickers. It's kind of like your watch list. And then this is a kind of a journal. So if you want to save a note, you can say my note today, add note, and then it'll stay in there. If I click it, there's my note, and then I can delete the note if I want. So you can do that on each ticker. So if you trade something or have an idea, you can put it in there and come back to it the next day. So we show the days until earnings, so you don't get wrecked if you buy a ticker and then didn't know earnings was tomorrow. So you can say this stock has got earnings in 5 days from now. I think you can click this. Yeah, if you click it, it'll show you the actual date and then whether it's before or after market open. All right, so let's explain this chart here. We've got some EMAs on the page and you can zoom in or zoom out. The EMAs that are on here, we've got the big red one is basically the long-term trend. So it's a 200 EMA that goes as back as far as the chart. This is a pretty new stock, so it doesn't have an EMA. I think the stock actually got listed right here. But like this one probably has, yeah, it goes all the way back. And then these other EMAs are meant to be for creating trailing stop losses. It's a good range. It's a good range between the white and the orange here. I forget which EMAs these are. I think it's a 9, 20, and 33. I think it's these three. So if you're doing a trailing stop loss, so if I click on, I can basically click on any of this area here, and then it'll give me kind of a range of stop losses to do. So I'll explain this panel here in a second. But if you're doing a trailing stop loss and you're trading for, like, let's say you got a trade open for 30 days and you want to just kind of see where this is at and just follow it. So depending on the stock ticker, the white line might be too tight and the orange line might be too loose. So you can make a judgment call on where you want to put your trailing stop losses. But generally in that range is a good idea. Let's see what else. So that's the top of the chart. The bottom of the chart is a plot over time of the two indicators that are on the leaf diagram. So we have crossovers and bots. And what this is about 50 different algorithms that we're trading, that we're tracking. And you can think of, let's say the entire market has X amount of cash that's moving around the markets, right? A certain amount of liquidity is just kind of floating around the markets. And people out there are automatically trading. You know, they have rules, they have bots, they have algorithms, they have trading strategies. You know, everybody, some people might be trading a MACD or an RSI, or they're looking at different indicators to kind of gauge whether or not they should be putting on more risk and getting more into the market, or more, you know, reducing risk and getting out of the market. And so what we're doing here is we're trying to front run when these bots turn. So let's say there's 50 of them and you got a score from 0 to 50. Right here, all those bots are out. There's nobody left. There's nobody left to leave. So most likely what's going to happen, unless this company's going bankrupt, is there's it's a bottom. It's basically a turning point because there's nobody left to leave. And the stock's just kind of floating there. So you would definitely, as a general rule, want to ride this move here. So from this bottom point here to this top part here, that was a, just looking at this random stock, whatever this is, I have no idea what Joy Y. So if I click on I can learn what it is. What is it? It is social media platform in Singapore. So was that on like Facebook in Singapore or something? No idea. But you can see that would have been a nice if you got in here somewhere, like anywhere in this area. Wait for this little turn. And then you can see the bots start creeping in. And then you want to front run them. So you got in here and then the rest of the bots followed. And you could have had a $30 to $34 move here in a matter of 2 weeks. Less than that. It's like 5 days, 6 days. So that's what we're trying to do here. Trying to find these charts where, you know, you're in this swing. You want to catch these swings. You want to catch these 1 week, 2 week, 3 week, 4 week, 6 week, you know, trends, and ride them and then get out. So you never want to be buying when this stuff is up here in the top in the red. It's just bad news. You're just going to get wrecked. But also at the same time, if you look at like a stock that's just absolutely getting murdered, you got to be careful as well. So like if I plant this seed with this all like negative fives, I'll plant this seed here and you can see that this chart is in the past. So this is whatever this date was. So back in June or something, a month or so ago. But if we scroll down, you can see these are all just stocks that are getting pretty much blasted. So you can try a knife catch if you want. So this is a bad one. Here's a really bad stock. Like this is just getting absolutely killed. Never gets above 200 EMA. Just keeps going and just keeps bleeding. Like that's just not something you probably want to be trading. But I mean, I don't know what this stock is, Scholastic or whatever, but I mean, this is like a nice, what, 3 year? Is that 3 years? Yeah, 3 year range here. Unless this was recently listed. No, it's been since 1992, was it? Oh yeah, it's a big book company, I think, right? So you'd be trading these ranges, but I mean, this is a very volatile stock. And then speaking of the volatility, we have a 12-month stat that we calculate here, which is right here, monthly volatility. So what this is the top and bottom range over the months for the last year is about 16%. So if you look at what, 30 to 46, that's the actual top to bottom, but we're looking at the average. So if you took like the middle of this whole range, it'd be about 16%. So if you were to try and trade this and you're thinking, oh, this is going to come back up to, let's say you think it's going to go to like $40 or $42. Yeah, that's kind of that percentage that you're looking at. That's what this volatility is. And so the higher this number is, the more volatile it is. So when I click on it, it's going to give me entry and exit stop losses. That's kind of based on this volatility. So I'll jump into that and explain that here in a second. We've got on the chart basically a 2-to-1 ratio, and this is not at any point to say you should buy whatever this is, Lattice, at exactly, you know, $53. $53 is just today. It's just, that's just what it is today. It's $53 today, and if the 2-to-1 stop loss based on the volatility of this range here, you could say maybe let's go for a $68 win, and if I'm wrong, we get out at $45. So that's 2-to-1. So if I click over here, it's the same. This right here on the right and is the same as the, what's on the chart over here. And it also has it here on the pop-up. So you can see you would make 30% if you make it to $68, but if you lose, you're going to lose 14%. And this is a pretty volatile stock, so that's a pretty wide range trade there. So you can see this stock's getting absolutely killed, so this is even more volatile. Let's look at something that's not, I'll just go to basics and just clear this. So we're just looking at top stocks and just kind of scrolling through. So you can see those other stocks that we were looking at were smaller and had, like, you know, one had 60%. You know, Apple's got 8%. This is more in line with bigger companies. So you got around about 8%, 8%. NVIDIA is pretty volatile because of all the AI stuff. So that's been going up. Google, 9%. So you can see these big companies are around between 7 to 10% typically. And then where's Tesla? Tesla's probably... Tesla's pretty high. So Tesla's 21%. So it moves a lot. So a lot of people, a lot of active traders trade Tesla because of how often it moves. So this is a pretty big range over the monthlies. But let's say you did want to trade Tesla. Let's say, zoom in here so I can see it a little bit better. Let's say you think this is going to bounce here and it's going to break out. So there's your 2-to-1 ratio. So you can make a win. And then if you lose, you get out that you know, $20 versus $40, I guess, $50, 50 and 25, something like that. So if you click on this, you can break it down and then you can build your own ratio. So if instead of doing a 2-to-1, which would be plus 2 and minus minus 1, you know, you could do 3-to-2, or you could do like a crazy 5-to-1. And then if you want to do trailing stop losses, which I was saying is on the charts, this is where those numbers are right now. So you could go between 9-day and 50-day trailing stop loss, and it'll keep track every day of what that is. So if you want to make adjustments on your accounts, you can just come in here and check this once a day and see where it is and make an adjustment on whatever your open trade is. So there's that. Let's see, anything else I missed on this page? So we've got some basic technicals here. These three buttons here will have pop-ups eventually. We don't have pop-ups for them right now. We've got to populate a nice little design for them. It'll explain the trade protect more. And then we actually have the news sentiment and the news article links that it's actually tracking. So we're doing some analysis on the actual descriptions and titles of these articles that are coming in, and gives you a census of, like, you know, what is the sentiment? Is this stock getting killed? Is there a bunch of bad news out? So I'm trying to find one that's actually red. Most of these companies with the high market caps tend to have mostly, there's one, what is this? Salesforce. So Salesforce has bad news right now, but right now I can't click on it to see what they are, but soon you will be able to. It'll be a table and it'll show the sentiment of each article. So that is this stats on this page. These arrows are the kind of like the slope of whatever the EMAs are. So like if I was on this day instead of now, then these slopes would all be red. So these would all be red if it was going down, if I was over here somewhere. So yeah, if you click on this, then you get the stop loss calculator stuff. And then below that, the leaf forecast, if you click on that, we get a different chart. And this is crazy because it's doing a complete backtest of the entire stock history. Going back to, we have data back to 1962. I think it's 1962, somewhere around there. And what it's doing is, let me go up to the top here. So I'll look at, I'm just going to clear everything, go to Apple. So I'm just going to look at Apple. So if I click on this leaf forecast for Apple, we are doing a leaf analysis of the top, I think it's 50 leafs in history that look the same as this. So we went back, Apple goes back to what, 1980? So we're looking at every day since 1980 when the leaf looks like this specific leaf right here, and then giving you an estimate based on all those days. So you can see every day that we tracked right here are all the gray lines, and then this green line is the average for those from today. So from today in 30 days, the average of the leaf of what it is right now is about 1% gain in 30 days, or 37% gain in 365 days. So you can actually scroll down and you can see all of the days that we're tracking. So you have 1999 was the closest leaf to today. So that doesn't sound good, does it, for Apple? Almost sounds like Apple's gonna tank. But we're going off averages here. So this is the average for the total of all these days that have similar leaves. So you can see, you can scroll through these days and they all have very similar leaves. So if I look at a different stock, let's look at like Nvidia, same thing. So the average for Nvidia, because Nvidia has been going up, but the leaf right now for Nvidia in the next 21 days is negative over the average history. So you can see all these averages. There's your loss. So this was saying that Nvidia is going to go down more over the next 3 weeks according to history. So it gives you kind of an idea of where the stock could be going over the next 30 days, 60 days, and 90 days based on an analysis of all the days that look exactly like today. So there's that. That's the similar leaf report. And then we have another one, which is kind of like the best case scenario report. So these are the best days in history. So the best average gains over the last 100 years are plotted on this chart right here. And you can see what their what the leaf looked like before it did that, and then what the date was. So Apple had a lot of, or is, what am I on? Am I on Nvidia? I'm on Nvidia. So Nvidia had big days back in 1999. Everybody did. Some 2010s. So that was after the financial collapse. A lot of big 2010 moves. So it's cool to see, like, any stock that we have in the system, you can see this data and see what the big gains are. So it gives you an idea of, like, what's the best case scenario. So, this stock could do 118% in 12 months. I mean, it already did that this year. At least Nvidia did. So those are some fun reports to dive into. You can kind of base your trades on these, I would say, between the forecast and then the monthly volatility percentage to try and get a base of like where, how much of a move you think it's going to do. But then you can look at the charts here and say, this is like, let's say Microsoft bounces here. This is a buy the dip opportunity, and it bounces at 418. I'm going to ride it to 450 and get out if it goes below 400. So that's pretty much the system. I'll go into the, up here on the top, you got my leaves, my baskets, my screeners, which is basically same over here on the left. My leaves, which is manage leaves, same thing. And then baskets, manage baskets. So you can reach that up here and click on the ones that you saved. And I can plant the seed and look at exactly. So this was a pattern I was looking at. It looks like a dragonfly doji, and it actually kind of represents the little dip reversal area. Wow, look at this. What is this? AAR, Aero Defense. Look at these swings. So it's $70, $50, $70, $50. And I mean, you can see these crossover indicators are just, man, buy, sell, buy, sell, buy, sell. All right, so back to my Leafs. So that was my dragonfly one. So you can add a note here as well if you need to this ticker. This would just be adding it to Google. So there's, I have a couple other ones that I was just messing with and testing. And then your baskets, which we've seen before, same page from the other page that we were on. You can create a new one by just pasting stuff in here and saving it. So if you have a CSV file and you just want to copy and paste the tickers in here, you can do that. And so you can actually click on the basket. So if I click on, I don't know what I have any of these. I have favorite stocks. I have Apple, Microsoft, NVIDIA, Tesla, and whatever this is. Probably just something I was testing. FAT, I have no idea what that is. But if I click on the eye, or I think you can just click on the, yeah, you can click on the name of it. This is just going to show you exactly your basket. So all those tickers that I just had saved are right here on this page, and I can review. So if I have a watch list of items that I have open or that I'm trading, I can put them in a basket and then look at them every day and then come in here and see where my stop loss levels are at and go into my broker and update my stop losses. You know, spend 5 minutes a day managing your trades. Pretty simple. And then I have my screeners, which is just what we looked at before as well. So this is just saving my screeners. So that is it for now. That is the complete walkthrough as of July 2024. So if you haven't logged in and tried it, log in, try it out, give us some feedback. And we're going to add crypto soon and lots more features coming. So that's the end of this tutorial. Let's make some money.